Dear members of parliament, ladies and gentlemen, health, one's personal health, is of course a crucial value. On the other hand, protecting that health is a basic core task for public authorities. But the way to do that should be in accordance to democracy, to democratic scrutiny and civil liberties. That's also crucial. And that's the essential item of the discussion you have today. I had the honor over the last year to chair a commission called the Global Commission on Democracy and Emergencies, an initiative of the Club de Madrid. And we worked at putting forward recommendations that could guide your work, the work you will do now. Ladies and gentlemen, we all know that the functioning of democratic institutions, the unfolding of democratic processes, and the protection of fundamental rights, particularly civil and political rights, have been indeed directly impacted by COVID-19 in all our countries. As states now are moving to examine the efficiency of their democratic institutions' responses to the COVID pandemic, a long list of legal, institutional, and operational reforms are being identified as necessary to face the next emergency, be it a pandemic or another crisis, to face it with a steadier foot. Global pandemics as COVID-19 are rare, but on the other hand, epidemics, natural disasters, financial crisis, and industrial accidents are emergencies that have affected large parts of the globe in this century, and they are likely to recur. For over 2 years now, the pandemic has taught us that the resilience of democracy and its capacity for development, self-correction, and innovation is essential to deliver in uncertain and emergency times. The protection of checks and balances, civil liberties, and the rule of law are particularly essential in emergencies. And parliaments are part of the essential institutions to the healthy functioning of democratic systems, and they suffered greatly during the pandemic. The introduction of the state of emergency regulation in different countries clearly shifted power to the executives. This, in combination with the disruption of parliamentary activities, meetings, contributed in some cases to weakened parliamentary powers and oversight. But nevertheless, on the positive side, I think we can say that lots of parliaments have also showed strong adaptability, resilience, adaptability to the pandemic, which in some cases led to increased efficiency, transparency, inclusion, and innovation. And parliaments and political parties also found new ways to operate through digital means, allowing for better participation, interaction, and oversight of the general public. As one of the key actors of democratic life, parliaments should be representative, transparent, accessible, accountable, and effective. And therefore, they must keep functioning, so that they are not sidelined during emergencies, as they also have a fundamental role to play to build democratic resilience to future crises. To protect checks and balances, fundamental rights and the rule of law in emergencies from Club de Madrid and the Global Commission on Democracy in Emergencies, we encourage parliaments to conduct in-depth post hoc scrutiny of their government's COVID-19 response as a basis to recommendations for improvement. And Parliament should also conduct in the post-COVID period a review of their country's legal and constitutional framework for emergencies to make sure the definition of emergency, for instance, adequately reflects the critical risks of this century, of the 21st century, and that the constitutional provisions for emergency declarations provide sufficient safeguards to mitigate the risk of abuse of emergency powers. Parliaments must also make sure that their plans, their own plans for emergency preparedness, are robust enough to allow the effective legislative oversight during future emergencies. Parliaments indeed should plan for flexible rules of procedure, swift structures and processes for legislative work, and the ready capacity to embrace digital technologies as an instrument of resilience. And they should also build upon the digital tools developed during the pandemic to create new and wider channels for engagement with civil society and citizens. Indeed, parliaments, as representatives of the people, have a particular responsibility in that regard, so they can play a leading role to develop innovative schemes and mechanisms to address the crisis of representation and to bridge the gaps of representation that affect numerous social groups, including women and young people. Having societal inputs into policymaking is particularly important when there are rights dilemmas or new concepts or rights that emerge as a result of the emergency. In the COVID-19 pandemic, for instance, the right to privacy came into a very sharp focus as it was contrapposed to public safety. Freedom of speech and the limits that can reasonably be imposed upon it to preserve information integrity and prevent life-threatening disinformation was also cast in a new light. Political institutions and policy-making processes should be redesigned to facilitate and incentivize citizen inputs into this type of issues and make decision-making more inclusive, responsive, and accountable. Finally, all institutions pertaining to all three powers of the state, including parliaments, should comply with international legal obligations and human rights standards at all times in emergency response. Derogations, exceptions to rights protected by ratified treaties should be notified timely, and any measure restricting human rights must be necessary, proportionate, temporary, rooted in law, and applied with equality. Ladies and gentlemen, these are just some thoughts and proposals for your discussion. I hope you have a very fruitful conversation. Thank you very much for your attention.